My name is Jenny P. Watson, and I'm really pleased to be presenting this event, which is part of the Singapore Literature Festival, and that's what these programs are, and co-sponsored at our end by the Postcolonial Race and Diaspora Studies Colloquium at NYU. And just a little shout out, there are some excellent events. There's two more events today in the Singapore Literature Festival, and one more tomorrow. So please have a look at your programs. For our colloquium, our next event will be esteemed Crystal Curry, who's going to be talking about Journey Book. Later in the semester, we also have Monique Trong coming to speak, the author of The Salt. So there are some good events as well. And also, I just want to give credit, artist's credit, to this beautiful picture, which was on the poster, and I did not have the technical skills to figure out how to put it on there. This work is by a young Malaysian artist, Kira Bahadurin, from Kuala Lumpur. So I'm just thrilled to have four fabulous speakers today, and I will introduce them. I want also just to tell you about the structure. Each person will speak for 10 to 12 minutes-ish, and we'll go with sort of creative writer, scholar, creative writer, scholar. Break it up a little bit. And then I think we'll have just a short break, and we can get some snacks and cookies, and then have a more open discussion. So let me welcome first Jeremy Tiao, who will be speaking first. Jeremy is an acclaimed writer. His short story collection, It Never Rains on National Day, which is available for purchase over here. Hi, Nick. Was shortlisted for the Singapore Literature Prize. Other work has appeared in The Guardian, Esquire, Auckland Rail, Ambit, Mianjin, Asia Literary Review, QLRS, and Best New Singaporean Short Stories, and has won Singapore's Golden Point Award. He has translated more than 10 books from Chinese, including work by Zhang Yueru, Su Weichen, Yan Deling, Yu Qiuyu, and Yang Kuanyang, and has been awarded an MEA Literary Translation Fellowship, a Henry Luce Foundation Fellowship, a Penn Fine Grant, and a People's Literature Award Cup Prize for translation. Jeremy's also a playwright, and his works include The Dream of Red Pavilion, The Last Days of Limehouse, and Floating Bones, which is a translation of plays by Hun Lao Da and Kwa Sika. Following Jeremy, we'll hear from Yikei Tan. Yikei Tan is Associate Professor in Cultural Studies and Comparative Literature at Stony Brook University and hosted one of the earlier Singapore Literature events on Wednesday. He specializes in modern and contemporary Chinese literature, Sinophone studies, Southeast Asian studies, Queer Asia, and colonial theory. His recent works include Rethinking Chineseness, Translational Sinophone Identities in the Nanyang Literary World, and an essay, In Search of New Forms, Impact of Bilingual Policy and Speak Mandarin Campaign on Sinophone Singapore Poetry, published in East Asia. He writes in both Chinese and English. Next up, we will have Alfian Saad, who is a resident playwright at Wild Rice, one of Singapore's most recognized theatre companies. Alfian has been nominated 8 times for Best Original Script at the Life Theatre Awards and has won 3 times. He's also won the Bo Cameronian Awards in Malaysia for Best Book and Lyric and for Best Original Script. His many published works include 3 collections of poetry, One Fierce Hour, A History of Amnesia, and News of the Manuscript, a collection of short stories, Corridor, and a collection of flash fiction, Malay Sketches, which I'm currently reading, and it's just a fabulous read. These are also available. 2 collections of plays, as well as Play Cooling Off Day, and he's translated 2 novels, The Tower by Isaac Kamari and The Widower by Muhammad Latif Muhammad from Malay to English. And I should have mentioned that both our creative artists today will be reading from their translations. And then finally, we will hear from Sheila Jane Bernard. I'm pleased to welcome Pierre to NYU. She's an assistant professor of English at Dickinson College, and her research centers on questions of race and identity in Malaysian literature and culture. Her dissertation, Rakyat Malaysia, Contesting Nationalism and Exceptional Multiculturalism, maps the contradictions of Malaysian multicultural. creative readings of Odam Asli, Odam Asal activism, alongside Malaysian literature, film, theatre, and political rhetoric. Benam's teaching and research are also informed by her upbringing in Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, and Honolulu. Her teaching has been recognized by awards from UT Austin, and her writing on Malaysian politics has been published in The Conversation and The Malaysian. So we have just a fabulous lineup today, and I'm just going to take just a few, very very briefly, just a couple more minutes, to frame our panel topic just very briefly for today. So, writing and translating into Malaysia and Singapore. So, like many post-colonial nations, Malaysia and Singapore are characterized by their distinct multiracial, multilingual, and multi-religious populations. Just last night at the Asia Society Singapore Literature event, there was a terrific discussion with Jeremy and Alfian and two Filipino writers, Jessica Hagdon and Gina Stoll, about the nature of growing up in multilingual societies, the legacies of colonial education systems, and the hierarchies between languages such as English, Spanish, Tagalog, Warai, Malay, and the political choices, political and personal choices, involved in becoming Anglophone writers. These are debates very familiar to any students of post-colonial literary studies, and they're especially interesting when thinking about Singapore and Malaysia. We have sort of a case study in similarity and difference. Singapore and Malaysia's histories, of course, are very tightly entwined, and during the colonial era, both were parts of the British Empire, and they saw profound movements of populations from China and South Asia under the British Empire. Malaya became independent in 1957, and Singapore joined it in 1963 to form the Federation of Malaysia, though of course this only lasted 2 years, until 1965, when they separated, as you all know. Just to give some historical perspective on the connected problems of language and translation in this region, we can go back a long way to the writer Edwin Mahu, so-called father figure of Singaporean poetry. He published a pioneering collection of essays called The Second Tongue, an anthology of poetry from Malaysia and Singapore in 1976. And indeed, we also have Eddie Tay's recent book of literary criticism called Colony, Nation, and Globalization, Not at Home in Singaporean and Malaysian Literature, which also insists on approaching Singapore and Malaysia as a single literary entity. But we might recall that in the introduction to Thumbu's poetry collection from 1976, he describes a brief effort around the time of decolonization to assemble a synthetic language using English as a base with importations from Mandarin and Malay. It was called Engmalching. So, not surprisingly, and perhaps gratefully, this was a short-lived enterprise. But Thumbu's musing on this failed project also indicate that the choice of English, which he describes as no one's native language, everyone's second tongue, carried with it a diminished sense of anti-colonial national identity, so important to writers of this generation. I think what's interesting for us is the way the complexities of multilingualism, translation, remain salient issues today for both writers, readers, translators, and nation states. So for example, Singapore boasts now a successful bilingual education policy, but it also gives rise to the paradox that one has to take classes in one's mother tongue, which Mandarin, typically Mandarin, Malay, or Tamil, whether or not that's really the language that your ancestors spoke is a different question. The Malaysian state, meanwhile, has taken a different approach with a very strong emphasis on the Malayanization of national and of course the rise of global English and new categories like global Anglophone and world literature make these choices more complicated, and I think the case for translation even more urgent. So, let's delay any longer. We're extremely grateful today to have our two extremely energetic scholars of Southeast Asian literature, as well as two writers who are not only acclaimed creative artists in their own right, but have also done the very hard work of translating. So,
thank you, Jenny, and thank you everyone for being here. I'm going to read from my translation of Wong Yun Hua's Durians Are Not Only Fruit, which is not the title in Chinese. In Chinese it's called The Journey of Return, but the publishing authors would sell better. Dr. Wong grew up in a rubber plantation in Malaya during the Malayan Emergency and has since become the head of Chinese at the National University of Singapore and the dean of Yuanzhou University in Taiwan. He is currently the vice president of the Southern University College in Johor, Malaysia. Dr. Wong is very astute when it comes to the positioning of language and culture in Singapore and Malaysia. So I thought reading from one of his essays would be a good way to provide text and context to start us off. This is from an essay called My Marginal Home. My whole life has been inextricably linked to marginality. Every place I've lived, both geographically and culturally, as well as my viewpoints and the literature I research, all of them rest on a border. And so my poetry and essays are a recollection of a life lived on the margins. My grandparents emigrated from China to Nanyang during the Qing Dynasty. My parents were born in colonial Malaya, present-day Malaysia. I was too in 1941 in Timor, Iraq. This small town sits on the west side of the mountain range that cleaves Malaysia on the fringes of the primeval jungle. In the past, because it was on both the north-south trunk road and railway at the border of Kinta Valley with its tin mining and rubber tapping activities, most people knew or had been to this place. About 6 miles to the north lay Kampa, a center of commerce, while the government seat of Dapa was 6 miles to the south. We went to Kampa to see movies, buy Western goods, go to school or see the doctor, while our parents had to make a trip to the colonial government offices in Dapa to pay property or land taxes or apply for various official documents. When I was 12, my mother brought me there to get my identity card, and I also received my citizenship there. Mandarin and Chinese dialects were seldom heard. Everyone spoke English or Malay. As a child, I envied the people living in that center of power. The commercial center was attractive too. We visited Kampa, but when the delicious food had been eaten, when the movie ended, when our classes were over, we had to return to our home on the border, where there was nothing but the river, vegetable farms, tin mines, rubber plantations, and the troops keeping order. Government. Outsiders referred to Timor as Sixth Mile because we were so marginal, so unimportant, that everything about us had to be defined in relation to the center. Geographically, commercially, officially, we were on the border and few people lived there permanently. When I was a child, the number of residents was so small that we practically all knew each other. In secondary school, my life was mainly in Kampa, but having to return home when the sky turned dark gave me a sense of being banished to the fringes, as if something was being kept from me. My first home was on the fringes of Timor, a wooden atap house on the bank of Timor River. It had a roof of palm-like atap leaves cut from the trees that grow by the riverside, woven together in such a way as to keep heat and rain out. This was the most common type of roof seen in the villages and towns that surrounded the cities of Malaysia. When it rained, we could distinctly hear water droplets striking the roof, which had the additional benefit of cooling the house. Later, as an adult, I realized that a common trait of those who grow up in the borderlands is the ability to withstand wind and rain. Whenever I went out and traveled to school, or returned home from the city center after classes, I had to follow the tarmac road and cross the bridge over Timor River. As a result, that road, that bridge, the stretch of dirt road afterwards, all reminded me daily that I lived on the fringes of Timor town. Coming from Kampa, I had to pass through two town centers before reaching home, reminding me every day of my life that my destiny was to live on the margin of the margin. When I became an academic, investigating the center and periphery in literature, I was actually describing the circumstances of my childhood, not just terms used in post-colonial literary theory. When I enrolled in Kwame Primary School in Tremont, and subsequently in Kampas Heyuan Secondary School, I thought I was entering the center, but each time I was disappointed. Both my primary and secondary schools were on the fringes of the rainforest, far from the city center. Heyuan was situated high on Kampa Hill, a half-hour walk north along Goping Road. En route, we'd have to pass by the English medium Anglo-Chinese School, whose buildings were on both sides of the road. Each time I saw the English school students, they had a kind of pride that made my heart go hollow. The English school was right in the city, while we were up a hill on its periphery. I sensed at the time that Chinese school students were afforded the lower status, and the relative distances of these two schools from the center seemed symbolic of our differing positions within British colonial society. Heyuan's location in the suburbs of Kampa made its students feel endangered, rejected. Anglo-Chinese students, secure in the heart of town, were spared this feeling. We were on the fringes of the rainforest, with no access to the material civilization of the town center, giving rise to a variety of extreme thoughts. We were engaged in anti-colonial activities and student movements to keep Chinese education alive. In order to fund a school building, we raised money everywhere we could and organized small study groups. If we were free in the afternoon, we worked on our English and Malay. We had more room for thought to develop. Between 1929 and 1930, Lao She visited Singapore from England. At the time, the bastion of English medium education in Singapore was Raffles Institution in the city center, where the Raffles City Mall is located today, while the Chinese high school was located far away on Bukit Timah Road, then a locale considered to be the distant countryside. No wonder Lao She was startled to discover that our Chinese school students had already developed revolutionary ideas whilst in secondary school. The secondary school and even university students he encountered in London had not yet developed such thoughts. In colonized countries, where the native people are pushed to the extremities, are neglected, even rejected, this ultimately gives them the space to develop resistance to hegemony, creating a language that encompasses many cultures. It's been 35 years since I left my home on the margin. As a child, I longed to escape from this place, to plunge into the center, and for more than 3 decades, I have indeed lived and worked in the center, but have made every effort to keep my mind in the borderlands. As Edward Schultz says in Center and Periphery, in modern society, the words center and margin do not refer to space or geography, but to values and beliefs, institutions and beliefs. I've always preferred to position myself at a distance. Bell Hooks states in Marginality as a Site of Resistance that when living on the edge, one develops a particular way of seeing reality, looking both from the outside in and from the inside out. One's attention focused on both the center and the margins, finally coming to understand both. This mode of seeing reminds us of the existence of a whole universe, a body made up of both margin and thus the margin is an essential part of the whole. Now I understand that the margin is the site of thought and also of resistance. No longer does it only have to be a place of deprivation, exile, and exclusion. Thank you.
And our next speaker is Professor Eve.
Thank you, Jenny, for inviting me again. I was here last year. It was last year, right?
It was last year. Actually, if I can just ask you to speak up a little.
I will.
We have a very loud air diffuser, so I'm
I'll
sorry.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Jenny, for having me again. And also, thank you, everyone, for showing up this training. So it's not easy to travel, but you're here. Thank you. Today, I've been debating on what I'm going to say or what I'm going to present for today's event, since we have writers here too, along with scholars, so I decided to do something different. So it's partly theoretical and partly just conversational. And so I give it a title about translational writing and inherent practice of Singapore writers. You'll find out what I'm trying to say with this translational practice or translational writing in a little bit. Okay, since we have our now like I'm very conscious in terms of how we pronounce it.
So it's correcting how we pronounce names.
Alfian and Jeremy here, who are practicing translators of work by Singapore writers. I plan to talk about translation in a slightly different sense. I want to talk about the role of translation in the writing of multilingual and multicultural Singapore writers. At the second Singapore Literature Festival 2 years ago, I asked a panel of Anglophone writers from Singapore how other languages in Singapore factor into their writing. Most of their immediate reaction was more or less, unfortunately, I only write in one language. This is not a trick question. When I asked them, I was not trying to say, gotcha, you only write in one language. That wasn't my intention. I was very sincere in wanting to know if we can think of multilingualism in the works of writers who write predominantly or even exclusively in a language of their own preference. Cyril Wong, one of our very famous Singaporean poet, said he writes predominantly or even exclusively, he touched briefly on my interest on this topic by claiming that this particular question makes him realize that while writing exclusively in English, dialects often come and go in this thought process. So I share with him my personal experience of thinking and writing scholarly work in mainly English, and quote unquote, reserving my personal emotional thoughts predominantly for Mandarin, or even my dialect. So I usually think about my emotions, my sadness, my happiness in Mandarin, but I write in English. So though the languages intermingle, especially when I need a very specific vocabulary to express my feelings, I switch between these different languages. So on Wednesday, 2 days ago, when I asked our wonderful panel of writers who were visiting Stony Brook, Alfian, Jeremy, and Ovidia, she's not here, a question on language choice, including Singlish, in their writing. Alfian said that even though he writes in English, he uses Malay to express his emotion, such as pain. Ovidia instead confessed that due to her family background, speaks only English and writes only in English. Her father speaks Tamil, her mother a Shanghainese dialect, so English is the common language between family members, amongst her family members. But I disagree. I read Ovidia's work and I listen to the reading of her work on Wednesday. It is clear that her Anglophone writing is filled with Singlish, and perhaps traces of her cacophony sounds and voices from her linguistic diverse family environment. That, I think, is an asset of Singaporean writers. I call this form of identity a translational identity in my book, Rethinking Chinese-ness, Translational Sinophone Identities in the Nanyang Literary Book. So I'm here promoting my book. The concept comes from the book that I published in 2013, but it's also something that is deviating. So I was telling Sheila earlier that I'm trying to zoom in now instead of talking about global relations. In my book, I focus broadly on thinking about Sinophone writers from writing in Chinese communities outside the mainland, in particular Singapore and Malaysia. I suggest that even though Sinophone cultures are distinctively different due to their diverse localization process, Sinophone subjects interact to learn about and from each other through various transnational networks, such as popular culture, politics, economics, and literary expressions. Charles A. Lockman, in his edited volume, Contested Modernities in Chinese Literature, describes such exchange between writers from Singapore and Malaysia and Asian American writers as a comparison that attempts to reference and draw parallels between their respective situations. When dialogues are formed among Sinophone communities, translation occurs as an inevitable and necessary process on two distinct levels. I want to take this critical edge of Sinophone and zoom into the case of Singapore to examine the role of translation as processed within the work of Singapore writers. So if you're not a fan of Sinophone, we can set that term aside, and I hope to just use it as a methodology and not a category. So by thinking of culture and identity as translational acknowledges the significance of linguistic change as an important aspect of socialization and localization for communities in Singapore, with examples such as the invention of Nanyang Secai, which is the Nanyang colors in early modern Chinese, or early Southeast Asian Chinese literature that's produced in the first half of the 20th century in Malaya before it split Singapore and Malaya. And also the use of Singlish today in a lot of different cultural and literary expressions in popular culture. In the past, in the 80s and 90s, we have Liang Wenfu's popular song called Singapore Pie. The Singapore ballad, Sing Yao, is one of those examples. We also have artistic renditions such as Guo Bao Kun, a very important poet who's like the father of Singapore theater, his work on multilingual theater. So the linguistic cross-fertilization in Singapore is a translational process. The linguistic cross-fertilization in Singapore as a translational process is catalyst to the cross-cultural contact among ethnic communities and within national boundaries. So I realize that I've not explained the concept of translational in the very specific way that I'm thinking of. We can talk about linguistic and cultural translation, but I'm also trying to be a little cool and use a scientific term to further this idea. So like the concept of translational in physics, in which energy is generated upon contact of bodies from inertia to movement, I believe the work by Singapore writers embody these positive traits of the translational because the network of linguistic and cultural affinity, regardless of language and cultural hierarchies, is the basis of a multicultural society as diverse as Singapore. It is this inherent trait that triggers or perhaps forces each diverse communities to move in time and space, along with the belief of sameness in dispersal or together in difference. This is in order to construct new subjectivities through the interconnectedness of people. So since my area is Sinophone, Singapore and Malaysia, I still come back to it, right? I will offer a Sinophone example here to exemplify how translation, linguistic and cultural is always already at work in the process of writing for Singapore writers. It's a little tiny, but I'm going to read some of it so you get to see it. So this is a poem by poet Chang Yao. Chang Yao is a slightly older Chinese poet, a Sinophone poet from Singapore. Chang Yao, literally his pen name means long tune or long song, and his real name is Liu Kechuan. Liu was born in Singapore in 1944 and was influenced by his father to begin writing at 13. He first published a four-act play, Snail, War Nail, in 1963, and a long poem, Three Nights, Sun Year, in 1964. For 10 years, the Chinese educated Liu stopped writing in order to focus on learning English. Besides poetry, Liu was also recognized for his fiction. He won the first prize for the Singapore National Microfiction Award in 1987. Chang Yao's Neighborhood, the poem that came out in the 90s, called Neighborhood's Affair, a short narrative poem,
Chinese is called 发生在我们家的事,小叙事诗.
This poem takes place, takes the perspective of a Mandarin speaker who stops to converse with his dead friend's grandson when passing by their flat. Aaron, the grandson, is discarding items belonging to his dead father. Before the actual conversation, Chang Yao summarizes the passing of his old friend Chen and Chen's wife in the beginning three stanzas that I am not quoting here. The fourth stanza set up the encounter between the speaker and Chen's grandson, Aaron, who speak, when the speaker sees old Chen's book laying in a pile of junk while walking past the Chen's household. This is a turning point where the poem departs from the first four Sinophone stanzas to adopt a multilingual narrator. The actual conversation between the speakers and Aaron is conducted predominantly in Mandarin and English, with loan words from the Teochew dialect. The speakers exemplifies linguistic code switching, a characteristic of bilingual and multilingual speaker, by switching between Mandarin, English, Singlish, and also Teochew. So Aaron, however, seems more comfortable expressing himself in Singlish, even though he quotes from the Teochew opera, Tan the Third and Fifth Lady, Qin San Wu Niang. He clearly does not understand the significance of the tradition, nor does he appreciate it. So here's the part of the poem.
到底发生了什么事,我连忙停步观望. Aaron, this book is Akong's favorite. 唐诗三百首床前明月光. Throw away, so boring to recite. Akong always forces me. Aaron, 双手合十,脸向青天. Akong, I don't like 明月光, sorry. You shall see this VCD. Ama always says, 但三毛尿, is better than delicious food. She always sing, Teochew Bak Ding Ho Li Nian.
My Teochew is not that good, but I try.
We say, Teochew no good, durian good.
So there's a connection with Jeremy here. Okay, so this is how it's played out. But it's really interesting too, if we look specifically into the poem, if you know the sound, right? So when the speaker reminds Aaron of Akong, grandfather's in Teochew, favorite classical Tang poetry collection, Aaron's response is throwed away because Akong used to force him to recite it. Recitation without comprehension mirrors the reality of how Mandarin has waned in significance among the younger generation who prefer to speak in working language English. The use of synonymic language like the Tang poetry becomes a choice that is determined by one's liking. I don't like Mueguang, sorry. When talking to a sister about their grandmother, Ama's VCD of Dan the Third and Fifth Lady, he makes a pun of the Teochew word that describes the sentiment of longing, right? Yulian or Yulian, with the tropical fruit commonly found in Singapore, Yulian, which sounds exactly like longing in Mandarin. So you have Mandarin, English, and Teochew, right? Intermingling. Ama's longing for her hometown in Changshan, the region known as Teochew, which is the same word for the dialect, has been disregarded by Aaron and his sister Michelle because Teochew is no good compared to durian. Even though the poem adopts a rather conventional style of 12 quatrains with rhymes in line two and four, the number of syllables in the rhyming lines in each quatrain varies. What is worth noting about the rhyming pattern in this poem is that each quatrain rhymes without fail regardless of the language used, Mandarin, English, or even Teochew. So they all rhyme in their own ways. Nan San Wai Ai Du Fu Lu Su Wang Guang Ni Sorry Food Good. Right, so there's a lot of this. I'm not going to go through all the details, but there's an intention to bring all these languages together. So while rhyming pattern poetry usually suggests harmony in tone and theme, this poem, by rhyming in two separate languages, highlights the cultural difference between two distinct generations of Sinophone Malaysian, Singaporean. Sorry. Not only do the rhymes deconstruct the poetic form, they also comment on the disjuncture between the old and the new. On the one hand, the poem laments the generation gap between the first and third generation Sinophone household, indirectly pointing a finger at the younger generation for disregarding their own cultural heritage. On the other, it critiques Singapore's bilingual education policy. The poem exemplifies the failure of the policy by depicting Aaron's lack of interest in Mandarin and his cultural heritage. and his choice of Singlish as his preferred conversational language. So interestingly, we have to note that it's Singlish, not English specifically, that he's interested in or he's comfortable using. Right? His low proficiency in Mandarin does not make him a competent bilingual speaker. In addition, his Singlish fails to meet the governmentally approved and grammatically correct form of standard English. Right? So, however, by endorsing the poem's criticism of the bilingual education policy, the quote-unquote Speak Mandarin campaign and the younger generation's insensitivity to their cultural heritage, I would end up, if I do that, I would end up endorsing the originality and authenticity of the standard language English and also the myth of the mother tongue as a given cultural trait. Mandarin is not the mother tongue for all the dialect groups in Singapore. It was used because it was made as the mother tongue in order to unite all the Chinese communities. Government policy. So I would also be looking, I would also, in addition to those two points, I would also be overlooking how Mandarin is a state-imposed mother tongue assigned to manage the Sinophone community originally divided by affinity to their different dialects. So to avoid reaffirming both the state suppression of the various regional identities of Sinophone community and the uncritical assumption that all Sinophone subjects identify with a cultural heritage passed down from their ancestors, even though there are several generations, they are several different generations removed from the ancestral homeland, a translational analysis of the poem is necessary to examine how hegemony in any form shapes local identities and experience. Since we're here to talk about translation in Singapore literature, not to critique a certain latent form of Chinese chauvinism in Singapore literature, I will end here. So far.
Thank you so much for inviting me and joining us today on a rainy day. My name is Alfian Saad, and I'm going to read a couple of poems as well as an excerpt, a bit of flash fiction from this collection called Malay Sketches. So the first poem that I'm going to read is written in Singlish. I know it's been mentioned quite a few times already, thank you. But Singlish is a kind of a Singaporean variety of English. We're not sure whether it's a patois or Creole or Pidgin. The debates are still ongoing and furious. But just a few features of it. It consists of some loan words from the different other languages in Singapore, Malay, Mandarin, Tamil. And it usually doesn't obey certain tense rules, for example. There's a lot of compression as well. So this poem is based on a certain event in the 80s in Singapore, which has become a certain episode of a social trauma. There were two children who were kidnapped in Singapore and never found. And a country where kidnapping will bring you the death penalty, this is a huge deal. They were never traced, and they were known as the McDonald's boys because McDonald's fast food company actually offered money for any information on their whereabouts. So this poem is written from the perspective of one of the boy's mothers. Missing. He go to school, never come back. I make police report, newspapers, crime watch. They even put his picture, he and the other boy, on poster with reward from fast food restaurant. I asked from the RC man, and I have it from the lift lobby notice board. He give me and also say sorry. I have it in my bedroom. Every morning with half open eyes, I remind myself, my son, the one on the left. Got calls coming once, say they saw him in Penang selling videos, or in Bangkok begging, child prostitute, they say. Sometimes no voice at all. Hello? Hello, who is this? I am your son. Then hang up. Last night, so many things to remember. His school is still there. I walk to it sometimes, pretend I'm him, praying, come kidnap me, take me away now. Got one artist try to draw my son's grown-up face. I ask him, draw one for every year. He say, cannot. Got one time, I was on TV, crying with school bag on my lap. Keep saying, good boy, always help me do housework. Now I say, let me do the housework. Let me wake up to the mess he left behind. Poem. I'm also interested not just in linguistic translation, but also cultural translation, right? So living in a multicultural society like Singapore, I always find that the fact that we're one of the races, so I'm Malay, always involves an act of trying to translate what Malayness means, you know, to the general public, and in Singapore it's a mainstream Chinese. Trying to make myself intelligible, legible. Anyway, since we're in New York, I happen to have like a New York story here, so let's see. This got visitors. Hidayah tried every means to dissuade her parents from visiting her in New York, but nothing seemed to work. Her father had recently retired from his job as a primary school teacher, and therefore could draw in his pension to afford the trip. She could not offer the alternative suggestion that would use the money to fund their pilgrimage to Mecca instead, since they had already performed the Hajj 4 years ago. You sound like you don't want us to come and see you, her father said. It's very cold here, Ba. I don't hear your teeth chattering over the phone. That's because I'm indoors. So we'll stay indoors too when we get there. What's the point of a holiday if you're just going to stay indoors? It was actually the summer holidays, so the guy was not being completely honest. Then she said that it was going to be very cold. The temperature would range between 25 to 30 degrees. However, Hidayah rationalized this would still be colder than what her parents were used to in Singapore. Hidayah wasn't so sure why she resisted so strongly the idea of her parents' visit. Her housemate, the only daughter of a property tycoon, had decided to spend her summer back in Hong Kong, but had generously offered to cover half of the rent for 4 months, which meant that there was accommodation available for Hidayah's parents, and she did not have to put them up at a hotel. Maybe it was because she had already planned her summer itinerary. She had secured a job at the campus bookstore and was looking forward to making acquaintances with other New Yorkers and exploring the city after hours. She had only spent one semester here and felt that she was still in a period of adjustment. In her class, for example, Hidayah often struggled to describe herself to others. Some of her classmates thought she was Filipino, while others assumed she was Latino. When she mentioned that she was from Singapore, there was a momentary look of understanding on their faces, which Hidayah knew was actually a misunderstanding. The next minute would be spent explaining that Singapore was not part of China, was nowhere near Hong Kong or Taiwan, and that she was not Chinese. Her classmates, who were a little bit more well-traveled, had a conception of Southeast Asia, but then it was often limited to the holiday bacchanals of Bangkok and Bali. And then when she also revealed that she was Muslim, she realized that this also required reorientation, steering them away from what they knew of Islam in the Middle East of the subcontinent. Ultimately, when she told them that she was Malay, this was often accompanied by another round of clarifications. That she wasn't Malaysian and that she wasn't of immigrant stock. Even if my ancestors came from Malaysia, she would say, you don't call it migration to Singapore when all you have to do is cross a narrow street. Even then, some of her classmates would mispronounce the word later, saying Malay or Malay. Hidayah decided that in New York, to introduce herself was not simply a matter of description, but also explanation. She often wondered whether she could somehow combine the two. Perhaps the secret lay the order in which she presented herself as Asian, Malay, Muslim, Singaporean. There were 16 different permutations of the order in which she was could be announced. Surely one of them would make sense in New York. Given this backdrop, Hidayah wondered how comfortable her parents would feel in the city. Of course, New York was quite possibly the most cosmopolitan place in the world, and people in general did not display any provincial curiosity towards outsiders. And yet at the same time, she wished that there was some familiar enclave that her parents could retreat to once the city's dazzling diversity began to glare into their eyes. A place like Chinatown, for example. The Malay diaspora, to the best of Hidayah's knowledge, was confined to the Cape Malays in South Africa, the Javanese of Sri Lanka, and the Javanese descendants of contract workers in Suriname. So much would be novel for parents in New York. Hidayah was anxious that she herself would not be seen as part of that novelty. She knew that her wardrobe had changed in response to the city's climate, but there might be other aspects that were invisible to her, such as a new accent or a certain posture or attitude that she adopted in public, less deferential, less of the wide-eyed newcomer sending out pheromones to potential muggers. She dreaded being quizzed on her knowledge of the best halal eating places around town. She often made do with kebabs and salads, or even where the nearest mosque was. Weeks breezed by, and one evening, Hidayah found herself at the arrival hall of the GFK. And then she spotted them. Her father was wearing a blue windbreaker, and her mother a beige cardigan. Her mother also had a pink tudung on, tudung is a hijab, printed with white flowers. Hidayah had never seen her parents dress with all their outer clothing before, and she wondered if their frugality had made them borrow from friends or relatives rather than purchase new sets. When they saw her, Hidayah's parents smiled. Hidayah remembered how when she was younger, her father would always call her out from her room when there were visitors to their house. He would knock at the door and insist that Hidayah appear in the living room to salam the guests. Hidayah sometimes resented the ritual because not only was she shy, but sometimes she felt like an exhibit meant to demonstrate courtesy, a gleaming proof of parenting skills. Now, however, this seemed like the most natural thing to do. A few passers-by looked on curiously as Hidayah took hold of each of their right hands in turn, bent down slightly and pressed it to her nose. It could have been something self-conscious to Hidayah, a performance of an aspect of her own culture, a culture she had been at pains to define to others. But it was a private gesture to her, a way to reconcile the solemnity of respect with the tenderness of affection. The bow was too formal, the hug too intimate. She recalled sometimes wanting to salam her mother before leaving the house, only to be told that her mother's hands were smelling of fish, which she had just scaled. But Hidayah would do it anyway. This time, however, both her parents' hands smelled like moisturizer, applied to stave off dryness in the aeroplane cabin during that 24-hour journey that they took just to see her. And my last one is and this was an experiment for me actually, so it's very interesting for you to share that. Trilingual?
Yeah.
Quadrilingual, because mine is just bilingual, so I use, but I still try. This is a poem in both English and Malay, just a bit of Malay, and I think my attempt to have Malay words, but somehow or the other, I think you could get the meaning for the poem itself. This was a difficult poem to write because it's based on my mom who passed away in May last year. And I started to think of mother tongue and the Malay language and the fact that she mostly spoke Malay with me. So this is called How My Mother Pronounced Words. Number one. She used to call me Nat, short for Anna, meaning child. The terrible intimacy of my child smoothened to a callous syllable. Now memory has whittled it down to something precise as a pin. Number two. But Nat is also a contraction for hendak, meaning want. Thus, to call the child is to summon one's yearning for it. Number three. In the end, there were no words, just her eyelids quivering, as if she were in a frantic dream, her eyelashes like black gills. I called her Ma, as I watched the spoon transform in my sister's hand. Lever to pry open the stubborn teeth. Razor shaving porridge off the chin. In the end, there was just mine. The doctor told us to apply baby oil all over her limbs. This would prevent her body from stiffening into the silhouette of a crone. We rubbed her skin until it shone, like council workers removing graffiti off a wall. No mourner should know that her final word was pain. Before, I began in her body, not as a zygote, in her womb, but as a thought in her head. Ma, na, ana. Now in my head, there is a womb. If womb means a place of raw language, shredded to echoes. Ma, na, ana. Ana, na, ma. Ma, na, ana. Ana, na, ma.
So it just occurred to me that my only complaint about alternating the creative writers and the academic writers is that I have fallen that alternation. So thank you, and thank you, thank you to all of you for being here. And again, thanks to both Julian Cole and Jimmy Watson for making this event possible. I'd like to open my talk today titled Malaysia Boleh, the Politics of National Literature and Language, for those of you who know. Malaysia Boleh is a rallying cry that Malaysia can. I'd like to open this talk, though, by sharing a heated exchange with you between two prominent Malaysian writers. In 2010, Malaysian poet Wong Kui Nam wrote a scathing review of a collection called An Anthology of Contemporary Malaysian Literature, edited by Muhammad Haji Saleh, a Malaysian national laureate. The anthology was originally published in 1988, but it was released as a second edition in 2008, and it is this edition that Wong critiques. In his review, Wong writes that the anthology makes, quote, an unambiguous statement of official Malaysian cultural policy. This is that Malay culture is the sole basis of Malaysian culture, and subsumed under it, only writing in Malay or Bahasa Malaysia is considered to be Malaysian national literature. Wong points out that only Malay authors and only works originally written in Malay are included in this anthology on contemporary Malaysian literature. He notes also that the anthology does not include any literature published after 1983, even in the 2008 edition. Wong concludes with this observation. If Malay literature is considered to be of sufficient weight by itself to stand alone as Malaysia's national literature, then Malaysia has to be a monocultural backwater state that has barely left the 19th century behind, as the cultural nationalists wish it to be, and not a country with a diversity of cultures and a literature that speaks with a multiplicity of tongues that it, in fact, is. Muhammad Haji Saleh, writing in the same journal where this review was printed, responded with vigor to Wong's criticism. In doing so, however, he ends up lending further weight to Wong's argument. Muhammad argues, quote, we all need a shared language to communicate with each other. This is the national language, meaning Malay. Should not the national literature of Malaysia be written in Malaysia's national language? Muhammad, writing in English, goes on to argue that English, as the language of colonization, should not be used as a medium for Malaysia's national literature. Instead, he suggests that the works featured in the anthology, selected works of Malay literature that are published in their English translation in the anthology, quote, try to speak on our behalf. They describe our reality. However, as you can tell, the "our" that Muhammad uses refers unapologetically to Malay Malaysia. This exchange between Wong and Muhammad demonstrates some of the central tensions in an ongoing debate over language, literature, and culture in Malaysia. It's a debate that's really about Malay versus Malaysian identity. And I'd like today to cover briefly just a few perspectives on that distinction in the first half of my talk. This ongoing tension, I think, illustrates how Malaysian literature, like so much of Malaysian cultural life, is organized along rigid racial and linguistic borders. These divisions, unfortunately, are central to Malaysian multiculturalism, and multiculturalism has sort of been a buzzword for our panel today, right? Ignoring material differences in the lived experiences of Malaysians, the state presents Malaysia as the exemplary example of an Asian nation, right? Uniquely diverse, yet wonderfully harmonious. So this is what I refer to as exceptional multiculturalism, right? Malaysia truly Asia, for those of you familiar with that campaign. However, the reality is that national policy on multiple fronts, including literature and the arts, prioritizes Malay culture over that of Indian, Chinese, Peranakan, and indigenous Orang Asli and Orang Asal communities. This brand of exceptional multiculturalism masks the deep divide between how Malaysia markets itself to the world and the realities of racial and literary stratification at home. The actual diversity of the writing and publishing scene within and beyond Malaysia offers a much more expansive vision of national literature, which I'll turn to in the second half of my talk. These writing and publishing realities demonstrate that Malaysian literature is actually vibrantly multilingual, diverse in genre and readership, and simultaneously local, regional, and global in its scope and circulation. Despite the efforts of state policy and some national laureates, Malaysian literature persistently crosses numerous borders and boundaries. So to return to the exchange between Wong and Muhammad, which I opened my talk with, right? That exchange implicitly invokes the 1971 National Culture Policy in Malaysia. This policy, for those of you who are not familiar with it, establishes Malay culture as the culture of the indigenous peoples of this region, and therefore the basis of Malaysian national culture. And I'm quoting directly here from the policy itself. It states explicitly that minority cultures must be subjected to review before they can be deemed suitable and acceptable for inclusion within the nation. So that means by virtue of this talk alone, I as an Indian Malaysian am probably not deemed suitable and acceptable. And it asserts the indigenous status of Malays over that of Orang Asli and Orang Asal communities. This definition of both indigenous and national identities ignores the fact that the Orang Asli were, as Sandra Manikam explains, part of the first wave of human migration into the Malay Peninsula, ancestors of the first peoples to reside there, if not biologically, then at least culturally and linguistically. And while Sabah and Sarawak's East Malaysia's indigenous histories are harder to trace, Barbara and Leonard Randaya note that the Borneo region was likely settled by Austro-Melanesian peoples between 40,000 and 2,000 years ago. The National Culture Policy's erasure of these indigenous histories and its sidelining of minority communities become then the foundation of the state's definition of national literature. So what has this debate looked like over the past few decades? From the 1950s and 1960s, writers at the University of Malaya in Singapore, were part of what Philip Holden describes as an explosion of creativity by students from across Malaya. These university writers, including Wang Gungwu, the first published poet of this generation, were invested in, quote, a common political project, the creation of a Malayan nation in which a Malayan literature would play a part, right? I'm quoting Philip Holden there. Their hope was for a polyglot literary tradition that would participate in the socio-political transformations happening around them. Their hope was crushed in the years following the race riots of May 13, 1969, which helped spur the creation of the Malaysian National Culture Policy. A few decades later, in the 90s, Saleh bin Joned famously took Muhammad Haji Saleh to task for his mindless self-congratulation of Malay literature. And I've got some key quotes from him up there. A little context would help, though. Saleh, as some of you may know, is infamous on the Malaysian literary scene for refusing to endorse Malay as the national language or the basis for national literature. Dawn Morais, my mom, whose dissertation is also on Malaysian literature, argues that Saleh's poetry, essays, and public demonstrations, often employing graphic language and blasphemy in their critique of the powers that be, have made Saleh, quote, very much the outsider, or worse, the apostate. From the state's perspective, right? It would also be helpful for you all to know that Muhammad Haji Saleh described Saleh's bilingual poetry collection from 2002, Sajak Sajak Saleh, Poems Sacred and Profane, as, quote, the most traumatic experience for the Malay literary scene. So clearly there's some baggage here, right? I think you should know. So in responding according to Muhammad's 1992 report entitled Kike Sikap Rendahkan Sastra Negara, which means don't look down on the nation's literature, Salih rejects Muhammad's assertion that, quote, Malay literature is as impressive, sahibah, as the literatures of Britain, France, and Japan. Instead, Salih asserts that it's important to, quote, be self-critical, both as an individual and as a nation, and that, quote, being intelligently critical of the achievements of one's country's literature is not the same thing as looking down on or menkina your literature, right? Salih advocates for a robust assessment of Malaysian literature and Malay literature, one that involves a careful attention to local context as well as global aesthetic values. Over a decade later, then, Wong Kui Nam's critique of Muhammad Haji Saleh's anthology basically echoes the same line of thinking. So in contrast to the Malay-centric definition of natural literature sanctioned by the state, contemporary Malaysian literature actually reflects the complicated diversity of the country and its people. It's a literary tradition that precedes British colonial rule and one that continues to adapt and evolve. I'd like now to offer a very brief mapping of some of the key moments in Malaysian literature as it stands today and in its sort of historical trajectory. I'm hoping that this quick sketch of the field, it is not complete, there are lots of ways to take exception to how I sketch it out, illustrates how Malaysian literature is multilingual, diverse in genre and readership, and simultaneously local and international. Before I do that though, I think there's an important and frustrating contradiction that I have to point out. In order to give you a sense of the diversity of Malaysian literature, I'm forced to use bounded categories, right? Racial, linguistic, and generational, to situate these authors and their work. My hope is that as this body of literature and scholarship continues to grow, there will be less and less need for these kinds of categories, right? That we'll eventually get to the point of talking about Malaysian literature in expansive terms without the caveats of race and linguistics and generations. So speaking of categories, early Malay literature is a good starting point, I think, for this overview. The classics of the Malay literary tradition, Sejarah Melayu and Hikayat Hang Tua, were composed during the 15th to 16th centuries and 18th to 19th centuries respectively. Sejarah Melayu details the histories of Malay kings and their courts, while Hikayat Hang Tua traces the adventure of the Malacca hero Hang Tua. Muhammad Haji Saleh has been responsible for important translations and critical studies of Hikayat Hang Tua, and he's also written a collection of poems inspired by Sejarah Melayu. Yet, even these examples of classical Malay literature are open to messier interpretations. While Hang Tua is invoked as the ideal Malay warrior figure, some sources actually indicate that he was of Orang Laut, or indigenous heritage. In addition, Barbara and Leonard Andaya note that the text repeatedly distinguishes between Malay rulers and Orang Asli subjects, this is in reference to Sejarah Melayu, while also suggesting at the same time a very close and sort of intimate relationships between these communities, right? Now, writing around the same time as these texts, the Straits-born Peranakan community of mixed Chinese and Malay ancestry built a significant body of writing in English. Philip Holden describes the Straits Chinese magazine as one of the most representative examples of this community's literature. He suggests that the stories in this publication, quote, negotiate a place for Asians writing in English in the colonial public sphere of the Straits settlements. University writers of the 1950s and 1960s, as well as those who followed them, imagined their work as contributing to, quote, a linguistic melting pot. They began building a body of literature that spanned the independence of the Federation of Malaya from British rule, the formation of Malaysia, including Singapore, Sabah, and Sarawak in 1963, and the separation of Singapore from Malaysia in 1965. Writing in English during this period and into the 1990s and the 2000s, these authors include, for example, Wang Gangwu, Wang Kunam, Yi Tian Hong, Loy Fernando, Saleh Benjonid, Shirley Yoplin Lim, and K.S. Money. Some of these authors were linked to important early campus publications like The New Cauldron and The Malayan Underground, and works published in these venues were known for their willingness to experiment with almost every form, language, and style. Some of these authors, though, later felt compelled to leave Malaysia, most notably Yi Tian Hong, who made Australia his home, and Shirley Yoplin Lim, who established herself as an Asian American writer and critic.
since then, Malaysian writing has continued to expand in multiple directions, and I'd like to offer just brief sketches and short anecdotes to give you a sense of the vibrancy of this body of work. First, scholars like Ike have proposed exciting ways for thinking about contemporary Sinophone Malaysian literature, right? He talked to you about Sinophone Singaporean. But he's looked at writers like Vivian Low and Chia Kuei-Xing, for example. And he situates them within wider regional and diasporic contexts through his theorization of, quote, the Sinophone as translation. He reads these writers as part of, quote, a diverse body of linguistic communities around the globe, a network of local and diasporic communities that are interconnected, as he argues, but not monolithic. Like Sinophone Malaysian literature, Malaysian Tamil literature also participates in regional and global networks. In November 2012, P. Rajendran, the president of the Malaysian Tamil Writers Association, spoke at a conference on Malaysian Tamil literature in the South Indian state of Tamil Nadu. The meeting was organized by the Department of Tamil Studies in Foreign Countries at Tamil University, and the event was even covered by the major Indian daily, The Hindu, which referenced the 150-year-old history of Malaysian Tamil writing, and as well 15 to 20 students at Tamil University who are now studying this field. The authors and scholars of Malaysian Tamil literature and Sinophone Malaysian literature illustrate, I think, the vibrantly multilingual nature of Malaysian writing, both within and beyond Malaysia. Malay and English publishing in Malaysia is also continuing to evolve. Independent booksellers and publishers, including Silverfish Book, Maya Press, and Buku Fiksi, are helping expand the corpus of Malaysian literature. In addition, writers and scholars in Sabah and Sarawak are working to garner greater attention for publishing and writing from East Malaysia, which faces additional barriers to publication and circulation. I don't have time, obviously, to talk about each of these efforts individually, but I think I'd like to spend a moment on Buku Fiksi because it offers an especially interesting illustration of the multilingual and multi-generic nature of Malaysian writing and publishing. Its founder, writer, and filmmaker, Amir Muhammad, has established Buku Fiksi as an extremely popular and successful publisher of Malay and English pulp fiction, specifically. And they have a significant fan base among young Malay women, primarily through social media. In 2014, Buku Fiksi recorded sales in the amount of 700,000 ringgit, and it went on to win at that year's London Book Festival the Bookseller International Adult Trade Award. So this is a small publisher winning this huge award at the major London Book Festival, right? Amir and Fiksi Novo, a branch of Buku Fiksi, have also been integral to cultivating a new generation of regional writers through a trilogy of Southeast Asian anthologies. Some of you may be familiar with this, Heat, Flesh, and Trash, the three titles. The trilogy was launched in London just this past April, and in Singapore at Kinokuniya Books just 2 weeks ago. The energies, genres, and geographies represented by Buku Fiksi and Amir Muhammad suggest that Malaysian writing and publishing is simultaneously local, regional, and international. The transnational dimensions of Malaysian literature are also reflected in the new generation of diasporic Malaysian writers whose work is enjoying increasing recognition. These include Tan Kuan Eng, who's based in Kuala Lumpur and Cape Town, Tosh Aw, who's born in Taipei, raised in Kuala Lumpur and lives in the UK, and Prita Sumrasan, who's born in Malaysia, educated in the US, she got her MFA there, here, and now lives in France. These three authors have, between them, accumulated a significant array of awards, as you can see up here on the slide. And I think the success of these writers suggests the increasingly international scope of Malaysian authors and their work, and I think that's a trend that also parallels the growing Malaysian diaspora worldwide. Finally, I'd like to conclude by pointing to a small but growing body of indigenous literature that should be a part of conversations about Malaysian. These include texts such as Highland Tales, published in August 2015 by the Alliance of the Indigenous Peoples of the Island of Borneo, also known by their acronym Formandaw. The dual language of Malay and English book was published, very interestingly, in partnership with a number of state organizations, and it documents the histories and stories of Orang Ulu communities of Borneo, spanning both Malaysia and Indonesia. There are also indigenous authors like Golda Mo, publishing fantasy novels that draw on Iban legends, and Jainal Amambing, writing children's books about life in Borneo's long houses.
I would like to suggest also that alongside these literary texts, we need to consider Orang Asli and Orang Asal activism and community initiatives, including land rights cases that are ongoing, advocacy workshops, and regional celebrations, as a body of texts and contexts that are central to understanding Malaysian cultural production. I don't think we can responsibly or effectively engage the politics of Malaysian identity without recognizing how indigenous lands, cultures, and communities have been exploited in the name of nation building and continue to be exploited in the name of multiculturalism. I see this indigenous, local, transnational, and multilingual mapping of Malaysian literature as being aligned with the definition of national literature proposed by Brian Bernards in his study of the Nanyang in Southeast Asian literature. As Bernard says, quote, no national literature is an exclusive or completed project. Instead, he notes that it is, quote, continually reshaped by the evolving interaction of the multiple languages and subcultures that together constitute the national based cultural production and multiculturalism in their messiest and most enticing forms, mixed up and unbound. Thank you.
Thank you so much to our four terrific speakers today. Let's take a 10-minute break. If you didn't get a chance to grab some lunch, please do so. We also have Emma from Book Culture is happy to sell you books. You can get them signed. And then we can come back and have a discussion in a few minutes.
Yeah, so we start tracking up.
Translator's note to your translation of Kamari, and you kind of you have to explain these sort of different formal traditions that exist in Malay literature, the Cerita Pokok and the Cerita Ranting. You know, I'm just curious, and perhaps also from the Chinese, you know, how does that affect your practice as a writer? I guess how does the practice of translation work affect the craft or the writing? For Sheila and Ike, and I was just wondering if maybe you could both speculate a little bit more on, I think, the role of global English in these debates, both of the kind of debates that you've been talking about. I mean, in Singapore, you're a little more interested in the kind of the Mandarinization, and you're obviously interested in the Malayanization of official culture, but how does that intersect with a very global hegemony of English? So that would be just to start you guys off.
Well, I guess as a translator, you move across a lot of boundaries. And writing in Singapore and Malaysia tends to form into silos. So often when you're at the Singapore Writers' Festival and they're talking about Singaporean literature, after a while it becomes apparent that they mean Anglophone Singapore literature, and that's going unsaid. But it's impossible to subscribe to these categories when you're aware, just as a translator, of the rich body of signboard work that is out there and how much of it is invisible, and then realizing that that must mean that there are other entire bodies of work that are inaccessible to you until someone like Alfie translates them. So it makes me resist categorization, and I guess as a writer it keeps me humble because I know that there are huge areas of my own country and culture that are blocked off, and so I can't possibly know everything, but I can attempt to at least know a bit more and to always stay curious and open.
For me, I translate from Malay to English. And I always found it to be a very productive activity, especially when I have a writer's block. So whenever I feel blocked, I would look at a piece of text in Malay and then translate it to English. And I find it very helpful. It's sort of the kind of runway platform that I need as an aeroplane before I take off. It's a kind of an enabling process. That said though, I do find it challenging to translate some Malay texts into English in Singapore, because as you would know, we have sort of like four official literatures, right? Because we have four official languages. What this has given rise to is what I call the situation of the four solitudes. They don't really sort of communicate with one another, and it's really surprising considering the amount of, say, translation work in India, for example, right? I mean, we really feel in comparison with those kinds of societies. So one difficulty that I face is that sometimes when a novel, for example, a poem is written in Malay, there is this idea that the author has the imagined audience is a Malay readership. So in the act of translation, sometimes there is this, do I then translate for this English-speaking readership, or do I try to maybe go towards a certain act of interpolation where, in reading the text, the reader will then become a Malay reader. So that's always been the kind of struggle. It's quite an interesting struggle.
I'm happy to start to try to tackle the question of politics of English in the context of Malaysian literature, right? You know, I think there are a number of things that need to be acknowledged. First of all, is obviously the place of English as, you know, I was sort of critiquing, and we all laughed in thinking about Muhammad Haji Saleh saying, this is the language of colonization, and it's the language of oppression and violence. And in the context of what I was talking about, it's a little bit complicated for him to say that, and we all sort of laughed, right? But it is, what he's saying is also true, right? There is a very oppressive history of what has been done with the English language around the world, in Southeast Asia, the Pacific, all over the world. But I think the other side of that, I always quote, and I'm teaching the work of Polynesian writers in my world literature class and had a chance to study under them as an undergraduate at the University of Hawaii, Albert Wendt, Raina Faitiri, Robert Sullivan, these sort of preeminent poets and scholars of the Pacific, say in their introduction to the poetry anthology, Fretua Moana, that this anthology of Polynesian writing in English is in English because Polynesians have made English a Polynesian language. And I think that that could be, you know, there are gaps in that kind of articulation of it as well, but I think that's there's a productive way of thinking about Malaysian literature in English as also a claiming of, yes, we have this colonial history, we have literatures in multiple languages, English can also be considered a Malaysian language, it takes many forms, there are particular varieties of it that succeed on an international market, and particular varieties of it, English pulp fiction by Buku Fiksi, for example, that succeed very well in Malaysia. So maybe that's one approach, and I think that just the last thing I'll say on that is, I think on the scholarship side, part of the way to address that problem is also to acknowledge as scholars what our limitations are, right? Right now, I can only focus on Malaysian writing in English because my Malay is so rough. I left Malaysia when I was 9. I'm not strong enough in the language yet to be, right? And was not ready to speak in Malayalam, which is the language of my family who's in Kerala. So I think if as scholars we are upfront and explicit about our own positions and limitations, I think that's another way to address some of the linguistic barriers without just making it an assumed base that this is where the conversation is starting.
I'm going to address this question in two different ways. The first, think about and they're both ways of thinking about global circulation of all these texts from Singapore. So they're talking about global Englishes in relation to global literature or world literature. So how do we see, or how do we think about Singaporean literature, Malaysian literature as just bigger production of global literature? Select Bookstore has this new project, not really new, it has been around for a year or two, this idea of translating Chinese Sinophone writings in from Singapore writers into English. I always wonder, in the past when I was doing my work, I was always wonder what really is the relationship between Anglophone writers and Sinophone writers in Singapore. It seems like there's this whole big gap between the two groups. But I think projects like this is bringing these two groups together, offering more of an opportunity for English readers in Singapore to understand what Singapore writers are writing and what are their concerns in terms of the topics and experience of Singapore's communities in Singapore. Jeremy himself is also doing this kind of translation in Pian's book. Someone who is so big in Singapore or writing in Chinese has never been translated to Jeremy than this entire collection. So that's extremely important. That's one area of it. The other area is related to what Sheila was talking about in terms of Malaysian Chinese writers. A lot of these Sinophone Malaysian writers, they publish in Taiwan. And they're actually from East, most of them are from East Malaysia, the ones that are not so much represented. And their work of publishing will come in Taiwan in English, but recently, this is also in Chinese, right? Yeah, recently this is the second example already. In 2004, there was a translation to the University Press, My Subsea Sleeping Beauty, right? In Chinese it's a very long name. So this was a novel that was translated. The translator, Valerie, I spoke with her, it was extremely hard for her to translate it because the use of Chinese language is still very awkward in terms of a mix of classical language and contemporary language to show that Southeast Asian Chinese has never really moved past the modernization period. So that was a very interesting project in terms of showing how global English is represented and failed to represent. Right, what is the cultural other. But recently, just in April, there's another collection by Carlo Rojas that came out in April, also through Columbia University Press.
This is a collection of Hong Jing Chu, Hong Jing Su's short stories. Hong Jing Su is now considered as one of the pioneers of Malaysian Chinese literature and criticism from Taiwan, but he's from East Malaysia. Right. So this collection finally came out. Scholars like myself, Alison Brooke at Oregon University, Brian Vanessa at the University of Southern California, we're all excited about it because we can finally teach his work in our classes. And I think that's a way to think about how global English can facilitate this kind of global circulation. Yeah.
Thank you so much. And of course, you know, we are at a university, and these are real issues for you know what things you can teach and what things you can't teach.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, let's open it up.
Yeah, my question is to Afia.
Yes.
So I was wondering if you could talk a little about how your processes of composition for poetry and prose are different. I mean, you could talk about particular issues of multiculturalism, and then I just want to behind the scenes look at your, you know, comparative processes for prose and poetry.
Right. this is a very difficult question to answer. Well, what form, I suppose, I take to express something?
I mean, that too, but I'm maybe what difficulties you face.
I see.
I
always think whether I write something that's in prose or in poetry is kind of intuitive. I don't need to mystify the writing process, but I do think a lot of times you're just working on instinct, right? And it can start, I suppose if I write a poem, most of the time it starts with, let's say, a strong image or maybe a particular line in my head, and I sort of build on that. Whereas with prose, I go into maybe a bit more of a storytelling mode. It's quite different. So I think they have different starting points.
We're talking about English, and I think Jenny's question was about
the
I also wondered whether even within the context of incorporation, was it also class inflected? And if so, what is the agenda?
Right.
Often one of them has on the other. So, and if that is the case, then what are the implications of that? And the other, I think, related kind of question is that we've often heard the word choice in a multilingual situation of choosing to write in one rather than another, but of course choice is, as far as it goes, there is choice, but clearly there are highly determined concepts in which languages, you know, one doesn't choose a language so much as it chooses one. So, I guess the degrees of, you know, of that are operating even in a multilingual context, just like they have no Malay or, you know, it's
very
and so forth. So, you know, and it's not simply a, at one level, of course, a failure of your own attempts to have a language, but at another level also in some ways.
So, makes sense. Yeah.
So I'm just wondering whether, you know,
I'm so glad you asked that question, because right before you were doing that, I was thinking back to my answer, and I thought, oh, I didn't talk about the past. You know, absolutely, in both, it's true of Malaysia and Singapore, English was the language, was and is the language of upward mobility, right? It's the language of social access, it's the language of education and access to education overseas, right, and business. And with it also then cultural norms and cultural bodies of references, right? Absolutely. And so I think, you know, part of what that necessitates, I think, is the bringing together, if we're recognizing that the politics of English language literature in Malaysia and Singapore are so tied to class, right, and race and generations, that we need, some level this sounds so obvious, but we need both scholars and writers covering as many different angles and perspectives as possible, right? In that, you know, like, I'm not the person who's best suited to talking about Buku Fixie's English and Malay pulp fiction, right? I would sort of not quite know where to start in that conversation. I'm not the person to go and study Malaysian Tamil literature because I don't have a language. But we need both writers and scholars, not just covering as in let's check these boxes, but we need to be building collaborations and coalitions between writers and scholars of different generations and linguistic backgrounds and class backgrounds and racial backgrounds in order to provide, I think, a fuller and messier picture. And I think every attempt of that is not going to be complete, right? And I think it necessitates also moving between different academies, right? Like talking scholars in the US Academy working on Southeast Asia, talking with Southeast Asian scholars in Southeast Asia as well.
I think the add-on to that is important for us to, especially for the group of us here who are representing Anglophone and Sinophone, to not forget that there are other groups that are writing in different languages that belong to different social classes.
Yeah.
But for example, Ying Pei-an's work talks a lot about the Chinese working class struggling for their own success vis-a-vis those who are English educated. But there are also other groups. So the Malays and the Indians are also working class families struggling in terms of their own survival in Singapore. Those kind of stuff are often neglected through this dynamic between Anglophone and Sinophone experiences. And also to think about Malaysia, we're talking about, Sheila and I was just talking about, say, East Malaysia, all these writers, they were writing about Chinese experience, especially during the age of communism in Malaysia. They oftentimes talk about the indigenous people around Asli, but their focus is so much on them as a token of suffering that they want to, the Chinese wants to identify with, rather than really talking about their issue. So we as scholars has the responsibility to deal with those issues that are related to race and class.
And class is also why the field of Malaysian literary and cultural production and Singaporean literary and cultural production hasn't yet figured out how to address Orang Asing, Orang Asal texts and contents. That is tied absolutely to race, but also to class, because it's about what languages and texts are circulating from those communities and what histories, therefore, are or are not.
Answering this question, I think, is part of the long process of decolonizing Singapore and Malaysia that we haven't done that much.
Yeah.
One of the ways in which the British colonial government maintained power was to pit the racial groups against each other, and that became the dominant form of tension in society rather than class race, especially as access to the upper classes came with an English education. And so the more multiracial elite existing in the Anglosphere have the impression that we do live in a truly egalitarian, integrated society, ignoring the tensions further down the road. That's something that we haven't really acknowledged, let alone with our soul.
If I could add something, just as a small thing, but in Singapore, within English itself, for a very long time, for example, that Patwa, which I call Singlish, has been a kind of a marker for the working class. Yeah. And I think you find certain writers who are trying to claim it, but sometimes, and give it some kind of legitimacy, but sometimes also there's a kind of slumming in Singlish, you know, a kind of ventriloquism also. And I think it gives rise to all these debates about authenticity, about, you know, that's not exactly how it sounds, but and you can tell someone from middle class background is trying very hard to write, you know, for lower registers, so to speak, working class registers.
Read it as English and not, you're just missing a whole layer of how that's supposed to be read. So how do you take into account that, or I mean, you guys touch on it, who are you writing for to the audience that is very important, but I guess I don't know where I'm getting at, but that's like part of something that I'm thinking about, and then on the other hand, like, Singlish is also affected by so many regional dialects as well, not just from the like my Hokkien is Hokkien. Like, how do you, and Hokkien is like a primary spoken, not really written, but it's more conveyed in a spoken way. How do you account for all of the those other things where you're trying to convey, you know, the form.
I think that there's some very interesting linguistic experiments being done, not necessarily in Singlish, but in writing in English that mimics the rhythms and syntax of another language. So you do somehow magically sometimes create a hybrid language where you know your it's intelligible to you, it's English, but then the rhythms are sort of unfamiliar. The musicality of it, for example, is Tamil, for example, Kias Manyam. In Malaysia, so there's this wonderful place, the Khor, for example, right? You read it or you watch it, and you're like, hey, this is Tamil, but how come I understand it? You know? So and someone like Harish Sharma, also another playwright in Singapore, he's writing all these scenes, and you have a working class character, and you know that their main language would be something like Malay, for example, but this character comes and says, English, but you know the rhythms and everything. So I think we shouldn't ignore also the musicality of language and the kind of meaning that comes from just the sound. Even sound that it can sort of detect off the page.
I think also as these are regions that are rarely represented on world stage, in a way we're at an exciting time where we have the ability to define and codify how these things are represented. Whereas with more established, say with French or Spanish literatures, there are established conventions of how you represent certain things in English. Whereas with Singapore and Malaysia, there are many things that you don't explain exactly, but you do have to come up with ways of representing. And I think the key is not to apologize or not to patronize, really, because I think it is patronizing to the audience to go, oh, you won't get this. Because growing up in Singapore, the first time I read an American book and came across the word y'all, but then you hope and you figure it out, this was on the internet, right? And it's not a dictionary, so you really have to work it out on your own. But I did. My background's in acting, and one of the things I learned as an actor is that the way to bring the audience with you is to make a choice and commit to it.
Yeah.
I was just thinking about what Alvin was talking about in terms of the musicality of our language. So is it necessary to translate Singlish? I think not, because it's the characteristics there. So it just reminded me of a book that is not Singaporean or Malaysian. It's by a Korean-American writer, called Dance Dance Revolution.
Yeah.
Yeah, so she experimented with so many different... Yes, yeah. She did a lot of experimentation with different ways of using the written English to represent languages from different parts of the world, and also futuristic way of speaking of communities that she created in her work. Right? So it's a dystopic kind of story, but there are a lot of different ways of using sound to write in a way that we can still somehow get it, but not necessarily fully experiencing it. So I think that's the question, is that whole inability versus the ability to fully understand.
I mean, if you can get through a Clockwork Orange,
consists of like an invented language, should be able to get through.
Yeah, I just want to echo both comments here and also something that I think Alfian and Jeremy said last night about the productivity sometimes of allowing especially foreign or Western audiences to be uncomfortable in not knowing and not getting it, right? And I just want to add to that that from a teaching perspective, I keep returning in this conversation about Singapore and Malaysia to Pacific literature, because just wrapping up that unit in my World Lit class, you know, my students and I are reading these Polynesian poems from the Fatu Moana anthology, and I provided it to them without, as PDFs, without the glossary from the back of the anthology. And we've talked about the politics of translation in world literature, and then we've turned to these poems. And it's really productive to have them do a first round of reading and discussion where they don't look anything up, and they try to figure out what they think it means and what perspectives they bring to the rest of the text that then influences how they're reading the text, and then walk as much of that reading back as they need to once they've figured out and we've looked up together what the words are. Right? And acknowledging still that even with the linguistic definition, as much context as I can provide, as a Indian Malaysian teaching Pacific literature in Pennsylvania, studying Pacific literature in Hawaii, that we're still not going to get it all, right? But that is part of the process. And David Damrosch, the World Lit scholar, has said that there's an importance to recognizing world literature as a process of like but unlike, and that it's okay to resist sometimes the need to make everything legible to everybody, when also we are just fine with obscure American and European writers who are celebrated for being obscure and are then, you know, elevated to the canon and never taken down from there, right? As we all pretend like we know what they're saying.
Well, and just to remind ourselves, I mean, a lot of colonial readers, had grappled with daffodils and apples and so on. So many of us brought it up all the time that we didn't know what they were, but we were learning poems about them and so on. So I think there is that thing. Or for that matter, teaching Jane Austen or Conrad to white American students who find just as much buzzing about poems and clothes and naval terms and so forth.
I just wanted to just add to that. I mean, I've had some lovely moments in my classroom. But one of the things that I'm kind of always very impressed at with Singaporeans and Malaysians who come, I think, to America to study is how quickly they can code switch out of Singlish and just have these perfect American accents. And I've had these lovely moments, like speaking of, how to kind of invoke a sort of regional dialect or flavor. I mean, going back, your poem, your wonderful poem about the missing children. But it reminded me of, Arthur Yap's The Two Mothers in an HDB Playground, which was sort of one of the first poems to try to do that. And then I've had students in my class suddenly break out with this fantastic Singlish to read the poem. And it's like, oh, I didn't even know you were, this real ability to code switch, I think. And I also really loved your story about the student in New York having to do these 16 circles of self-identification and self-translation. I think we have one time for one last question.
This gentleman was.
Well, how about we have both questions and then they can answer it. So, very quickly,
I was thinking about one of the first Malaysian characters in English writing, which is Joseph Conrad admires for, that has to do with the condition of women and the problem of the nervous condition of the female character in English literature. And also how the channel between England and the continent at that time was elaborating an idea of hysteria and an idea of woman as a peculiar victim of suffering like she has been described. In contemporary times in Africa, you see that there is Tanganyika who wrote Nervous Condition, but at the same time, in Conrad, there is Edward who writes The Wasteland with a quotation from Conrad. And then they come the First World War and the Second World War to see that what Conrad predicted was not only the post-colonial, it was something bigger than that. In Latin American writers right now, there is a way of going back to Conrad because certain writers consider that experimentalism and magical realism are tyrannical. So there are certain writers from Colombia, after Marcus, who are trying to write a new novel of Latin America, similar to Nostromo by Joseph Conrad, that is set in Costaguana, a country that is Costa Rica, Guatemala, and Nicaragua. And he is changing all that narrative in Latin America.
All right, thank you. And then,
right.
Last question.
I just wanted to ask about the relationship of Malay literature between Singapore and Malaysia. What extent it crosses over and those audiences mix and the texts themselves travel and are mixed or whether or not they're translated.
My short answer to that question is that I am still figuring it out. And in fact, one of my questions to Alfian on the train coming back from Long Island on Wednesday, I said to him, so what are Malay and Singaporean, what are Singaporean writers thinking about Muhammad Haji Saleh? Like, what does that conversation look like? And so we both went back and forth, sort of some speculation, some sense from Alfia, some sense that maybe this isn't even a conversation that is happening. I think for as close as we are as two countries,
sometimes there isn't as much. But that being said, and I'll let Alfian speak to this, I also know that there are a lot of amazing collaborations in the theater world between Singaporean and Malaysian artists, right? So, sorry, I didn't mean to say you're responsible for taking that. Just,
is it because I is Malay?
well, I was referencing you as the playwright. I didn't want to put you in a position of speaking for that. But,
it's not easy to trace, but I think sort of if I can talk about it in a very simplistic kind of manner, that the two countries were one, and Singapore was in a sense the center of Malay literature, journalism, publishing. So prior to our separation from Malaysia in 1965, so that center sort of shifted northwards to Kuala Lumpur, capital of Malaysia, and has been there ever since. So there is a sense that the Singapore Malay writers are a little bit dispirited. They don't have as much state support as their cousins in Malaysia. Their books are not really studied in the national curriculum. So there's this sense of inferiority as well. Also, this sense of, should I try to break into the Malaysian market? But at the same time, feeling that the Malaysian writers are also very territorial. I'm going to let these people in. And a lot of this arising from certain stereotypes about one another. Yeah. So about how Malays in Singapore are sometimes seen as less authentic because they live in, they're minorities in the country.
You're immigrants.
that they're under the heel of the Chinese, that they are oppressed. And there's a sense that the Malaysian literacy not so open, not so accepting, and also that inferiority complex. I don't know whether in Chinese literature, so there's a sense that the center is elsewhere, they're at the periphery, and therefore they are less.
The interesting thing with Singapore Malaysian writing is that for a Singapore Malaysian versus Singapore writing is that Singapore and Singapore writing is more concerned about the local experience in terms of what comes after the independence. But for Malaysian Singapore Malaysian writers, their focus is a lot on the past, which is the period of the communism. The communist period. So that's something that Singapore writers cannot talk about, cannot write about, right? So there's this split between the two groups, and the Singapore Malaysian writers ends up finding a different location besides Malaysia, a different location to publish their work, which is Taiwan, which for them, they will be able to talk about the struggle with communism via the Malaysian government, not China. So it becomes extremely interesting in that kind of dynamic. Yeah.
There's also a nostalgia for the past with Sinophone Singaporean writers. Mm-hmm. And that tends to be education-based, to a time when there were Chinese schools and universities. And it's never explicitly said, but there were all Chinese communities and they didn't have to integrate. And this was seen as a kind of golden time of Chineseness. Yeah. That there is a longing for, and it's painted in a really rosy shade. Times were simpler, sit by the drain and catch spiders, and be understood. I think both countries, Sinophone writers see themselves on the periphery, but in this case the center is the past.
I'll just add very one quick sentence. I think that in some way sort of sums up this panel and portions of the festival, right? Like, I think the comments and the conversation points very clearly to why national and even regional categories, as expansive as they try to be, are still so limited and problematic, right? Because you start seeing, just in the comments that the three of them just made, all the fractures and fragments within Singapore, within Malaysia, and then between the two. It could just keep branching into new fractures, right?
And shooting outwards.
And then shooting outwards.
Right. Please join me in thanking.